In this lecture, we are going to talk about mounting issues. For this purpose, I will show you a practical example of a building integrated photovoltaic system. During the design of a PV system, it is very important the way how to mount PV modules. For example, you can have aluminium supporting structure on which you attach the module. As you can see in the picture at the bottom right, nowadays in the market there are some specific tiles for the roof with the typical shape of standard tiles, but then also embedded with metallic structures onto which aluminium frame can be mounted, and on top of them PV modules can be placed. Basically, there exist mounting frames of all types. There is also the possibility to have wooden supporting structures, and this is something appealing for countryside applications. The important thing is that you should have always sturdy foundations, especially in case of windy areas, in order to prevent that the load of wind on these very large flat surfaces do not damage the structure of the modules. Once the support structure and the frames are settled, the next step is to choose the appropriate electrical connection technology. Different choices are available, for example, the screw clip to use with the cable and the sleeve, or the screw connection with the cable terminal, or even the spring tension clip. In general, the externally insulated plug-in connector is the most widely used nowadays, which is designed for outside usage, such as underwater during rainfall. Now, I'll show you a couple of pictures of a building integrated photovoltaic system of 6.9 kilowatt peak, realized in Slovenia as an example. This is the same building that you have seen in the previous video, and it refers to a TT13 topology with an equipotential bonding bar. First, the engineers started with the top view of the environment surrounding the building. They individuated the south, and you can see that the roof of the building is not perfectly aligned with it. The part of the roof to cover with the PV panels was formed by means of a simple energy algorithm, and the area available is around 100 square meters. The modules used are shown in the next slide, and to cover this surface, 120 of them are required. The PV module choice is something that has to do with the budget, available area, and the calculated energy yield. By choosing a certain type of module, you have to fulfill these three requirements together. Engineers, in this case, chose this type of module with a rated power of 57.5 watt peak to fit the 120 modules area required. The modules were sold with a specific framework called the SolRiff, and that is harder than a normal flat framework. This choice was taken because this PV system was realized in Slovenia, next to the Alps, where a lot of snow falls during winter time. This special framework has the characteristic to trap the water in this little channel, and thanks to a specific tilting, the molten water is expelled by the roof, avoiding the ice formation. This was the installation site. They decided to do everything as much as sustainable as possible, so also the roof and the framework are made up of wood. Here you can see plastic tubes that host inside all the cabling that will connect the modules to the other electrical components in the basement of the house. As you may notice, this is a very challenging landscape. There are mountains all around, and thus a lot of scattered light due to the snow in winter. As a consequence, they needed to use a PV technology that works more or less steadily even in condition of non-direct illumination. That is one of the reasons why they did not select, for example, crystalline silicon technology, which is potentially more powerful, but its performance largely decreases as soon as you do not have much direct irradiance. After 2 days of work, all the modules were placed, and this is the result. On the left, you can see that also the lightning protection system as earthing conductor is mounted on top of the edge. Here, the tiny space of about half centimeter wide in between the modules is visible. As already anticipated, this is for getting water from molten snow. Indeed, during the PV design, it is important to take into account ways how to redirect water, and more in general, ways to well adapt the system to the specific environment. In this case, a building in mountains with a lot of snow during winter. On the back side of few selected modules, they were also installed the thermocouples to monitor the temperature and send this data to the inverters, which can accept sensor cables in order to take into account the temperature of the modules. They also installed a wind and a radiation sensor that are here highlighted. This is the schematic now of the 120 PV modules posed on the rooftop. To fulfill the 6.9 kilowatt peak, they chose three inverters rated 2.5 kilowatt peak at the DC side. Hence, the matrix of the PV modules was divided into three parts. As you can see from the representation of the inverter, each inverter has four cables coming in at the DC side, meaning that it can host four strings of modules. Here, the subdivision in strings for each of the three parts composing the PV system is depicted. You can recognize G1, G2, G3 and G4 in blue, and these four strings of 10 modules each come as input in the 2.5 kilowatt peak inverter. All these cables enter the house and go all the way down in the basement. Now, I want to point out that in normal household, you have around 3 or 4 kilowatt peak, and hence you are still allowed to use a monophase circuitry. However, for a bigger PV system such as this one, technically you can still use one phase to be connected to the grid, but then in certain moments you would need to feed so much power on only one phase that the other two would be unbalanced. Therefore, there are rules that state that above 3-4 kilowatt peak installation, you are advised to make a circuitry with the three-phase installation. Here we have the three single-phase inverters, and below them there are the web box for monitoring of all the measured parameters such as wind, irradiance and temperature. Then we have the AC and DC cabinets. The latter receives the cables directly from the roof and that's the input for the three inverters. On the other hand, the AC cabinet has the cables coming from the inverter and cables that are going outside to the building. On the left, you can see a web box for monitoring all the parameters measured. Indeed, wind, irradiance and temperature cables arrive here. Let's have a look inside the DC cabinet. All these cables on top come from different strings. Then the positive extremities go into the junction terminal, while the negative into the DC fuses and then to earth. So basically here strings are brought together and the outputs are these three pair of cables, which are the DC side of the inverter. The fuses and also the arrestors have the task to interrupt the string in case of overvoltage for safety reasons. In the AC cabinet, we have the AC output from the inverters coming on top. Then you have, once again, a fuse per each phase. Next to them, we have the neutral, which goes to the equipotential bonding bar located on the bottom right. Here also the local protection to earth, PE, is connected. On the left-hand side, there is also the main three-phase switch, and everything that passed by here is directly connected to another small cabinet from the electric company that is away from the house. This last slide concludes the videos related to mounting issues, and in the next group of videos, we will talk about the reliability of PV modules.